Everybody, welcome to this webinar. My name is Alana. I am the strategic partner for the Latitude Group in Europe. I am based in Portugal, and I spend most of my time traveling all over Europe, looking after the different investment programs that we offer in the group. I'm very fortunate today to be joined by Nicole. Nicole, thanks for your time. I know it's a little bit later in Greece, but we all know people in Greece work until the sun sets quite late, right? So thank you very much for joining us. If you'd like to just introduce yourself to our group, please.
Thank you, Lana. So hello from me too. My name is Nicole Barlogiani. I am based in Athens, Greece. And yes, it's still day here, although a little bit late. So I would just like to let you know that in Immigris, our company, we are based in Athens, Greece, in the center of Athens. We are a group of Greek qualified lawyers that we have an expertise in real estate and immigration law. And we service hundreds of investors every year since the Golden Visa program started in Greece.
Thanks, Nicole. It's good to have you. Good to have you with us today. I'd like to just introduce the Latitude Group briefly. We are a global citizenship and residency by investment company. We're an advisory practice that specifically deals with private clients. We have successfully helped 6,500 clients over the last 11 years to obtain either their citizenship or their residency goals successfully. One of the things that makes us unique is that we have an investment advisory business that specifically deals with the investment migration industry on the government side. So we work closely with governments to assist them and help them and advise them on how best to structure their programs to achieve their goals. And what that brings to us is it adds that additional information that we have available when we start consulting with our clients to understand exactly what it is that countries are looking for when they create these programs. And that helps us to structure our clients' solutions a little bit better. It also makes it quite interesting because we always know what is coming, whether it's good or bad. And maybe in the case of Greece, we weren't all surprised when the changes were announced. The other thing that's good to note about our business is all of our consultants are members of the Investment Migration Council, and we are the representative regional office for the Investment Migration Council in the Middle East. So we take our role in terms of compliance in the industry quite seriously. This is a picture of the global presence of our business. And the reason why we show this slide is just to reassure our investors and our clients that we have offices all over the world. And that's important, not just because we are able to assist our clients in the jurisdictions where they come from, but we also have offices and representative offices in all the jurisdictions where we take our investors to. So we can help you from the point of origin to the point of delivery, wherever you end up obtaining your citizenship or your residency. We have 140 employees today, and we speak 14 languages amongst us. And yesterday when I had a chat with Nicole, she told me that she spoke a few more languages. Nicole, just remind me. Oh, of course, you speak Greek, you speak English.
And then I speak German and Romanian. Actually, I'm fluent in both these languages.
Okay, well, we definitely don't have Romanians or Germans on staff, so we can add that and make it 16 languages that we can help our clients in. So this is just an overview of the business. Once we look at how we approach a client's citizenship and residency planning, it's very much part of a holistic financial planning process. And I think all of us have been through this as investors. You know, every year when you sit with your financial planner and you go through your estate plan and think about your tax and education and how to diversify your assets, citizenship and residency has become part of that holistic planning process for many of our clients, because it can create so much more benefit and opportunity within their bigger holistic estate planning. So for us, this is just part of one of the financial tools that investment and wealth advisors have available when they deal with their clients. If we look at the reasons why people specifically apply for second residency and what they look at, Michelle, you can definitely add some information here. Sorry, Nicole, you can add some information here because you deal with so many clients as well. And why do they specifically come to Greece? What is it that people look for when they apply for residency in Greece?
I would say the first thing that they look for not in Greece, but in general, is how fast the process is. And in Greece, the process is very fast. So I think that's number one. Number two is safety. Greece is a country that their investment, I think it's worth. It has worth in the sense that they will make a good investment and then they can benefit from that. So I believe these are the most important reasons.
Yeah, interesting. I think just generally when clients come to us for residency, this is what they're looking for. A second home, a good investment, potentially completely different lifestyle, different quality of life, climate, environment. Somebody said to me one day, all I want is fresh air. And you know, when you live in beautiful places, like you live in Greece, I live in Portugal, well, one doesn't always remember that there are other parts of the world that don't have that. So fresh air is one of the boxes that has to be ticked. And of course, education opportunities. The one thing that we don't have in Greece is employment opportunities. So many of our other European residency programs offer you the right to work, but Greece does not do that. And the last point is mobility for many of our investors. And I think with today's audience, specifically out of the US and Canada, mobility is not necessarily such a big deal because your citizenship already allows you access to Europe and to the Schengen countries. But for many of our other investors, that is not the case. So when you, like me, when you're born in a country that doesn't give you the right to access Europe, then actually having a European residency card becomes a very big a big plus. So mobility becomes a big positive for people when they apply for residency somewhere else. If we talk specifically now about the changes in the program, we saw some changes already last year, Nicole. So it was a little bit disheartening when so fast on the tracks of that change, we already have another looming increase. Last year, we saw an increase from 250 to 500,000 in large parts of Athens, the bigger Attica region, Thessaloniki, Mykonos, and Santorini, and very small parts of Athens where you can still make a good investment for 250. But what's happened in the 500,000 area specifically? So today, if we had to look at where people would invest in and around Athens, what can you get for 500,000? Where would you go?
I would say that you may still find some good properties in this price in the center of Athens. So, and the center of Athens has some amazing areas. So still in Kolonaki, for example, area, you can still find something for 500,000. Then it's not so often, but you can still get something for this price in the south coast of Athens. Which is Phaliro, Alimos, areas like that, Elliniko. And well, that's, you know, something very important if you can find a property there, because we have the Ellinikon project. I'm sure you're aware of it and
yes.
How big it is.
We'll talk about that in a moment. That's definitely increased prices already. I think important to note here on this slide is the fact that if you want to qualify for any of the current properties and the current prices, 250 in the qualifying areas or even 500 in the already more expensive areas, then you have to be able to make a 10% deposit before the end of August. Otherwise, you will not be able to qualify under the current minimums. If we just look at what the regulation is now, in March, the Prime Minister announced that prices will increase. And of course, we all hoped that this would last until maybe another year or two, but we were unpleasantly surprised by the price increases. I think though, if you look at some of the areas where, especially in the 500,000 euro category, places like Vukliameni, so some of the more expensive parts, places like Lefada, it's already very hard to find property at the 500,000 euro level. So I don't think that's particularly surprising that it's increased that much.
No, not at all. I mean, the areas that you mentioned, they now, the properties there are much higher than 500,000. So people who want to invest there will still keep investing even with 800,000.
Yeah. No, I saw some changes over the last few years. And, you know, you continue to look for value in areas where people invested 5 or 10 years ago, and it's just not the same. It's just not the same market anymore.
Definitely.
If we just look at- if we look at this, just this a breakdown of how things are changing. So at the moment, and we'll look at specific areas that you can still invest in the 250 category. But it's quite a large jump if you look at places like Piraeus, which we'll talk about in a moment. That the minimum is going up in all of Athens, so not just parts of Athens now. You will have all of Athens will be only available at the 800,000 euro level. So that's a significant increase in cost. So for people that have been looking at this program, I'm sure you must have seen an increase as well in activity in the last few months. People that have potentially been sitting on the fence or trying to get their assets sorted and their liquidity in place. Now is a very good time to start this process. Otherwise, you will pay significantly more for properties that you could potentially today get at 250. And then, of course, the 500,000 areas are also going up. To 800,000. If we look at just a couple of areas, and so Piraeus, you mentioned the Hellenikon project that is a little bit further on the coast, but the Hellenikon project is part of a much larger. Athenian redevelopment project. So the total value of that infrastructure redevelopment is about 10 billion. And the Piraeus port area sits right at the edge of that. Piraeus is the third largest port in Europe. And we've seen a lot of development in Piraeus over the years since I went there the first time, a couple of years ago, maybe 7-8 years ago. It was very much an industrial port, right? That's where all the ferries dock and the tourist boats come in. But there wasn't large parts of Piraeus that was beautiful and developed. And we're seeing now that a lot of development is happening in that area. Can you just talk us through a little bit of what is happening in the Piraeus area specifically?
Sure. So in Piraeus at the moment, I mean, apart from the fact that, you know, you mentioned how important the area and the port itself is, because it's not just that it's the third largest port in Europe. It's just the port that takes us from Athens to all the Aegean islands. So it's a very busy area. You get a lot of new constructions, brand new buildings there at the moment, which wasn't the case some even 3, 4, 5 years ago, which is, you know, recently. Also, it's an area that is very close to the center of Athens. It's just 10 kilometers away. And in my opinion, it's a very, very interesting area because due to how, you know, how much people you get from also maritime companies that they are based there, having a property there means that it's always rented out. There is no way that if you make an investment there, you will not have a property that, you know, eventually will make you money.
Yes. Because there's obviously large shipping businesses down there. I know there's a metro stop, there's a train stop. It's very easily accessible to the rest. So kind of easy access to the rest of Europe is always good when you're looking at long term lettings of any property. But I think the biggest value here will be the capital appreciation that people will see in an investment in this area, because it's part of the largest infrastructure development project in Europe. It's amazing what's happening at the at Hellenikon. I think when they announced the amount was 7 billion in 2017. That was the expected value of the redevelopment. I'm sure it's gone up by now, as with all things building related.
No, it's amazing what they will do with the Athenian Riviera. It will be something extraordinary when it's done.
Yeah, and we've seen that there's been a knock-on effect, right? It's not just the Piraeus port area, because there's a couple of marinas along that coastline. Alimos Phalerou, Glyfada has its own marina, Vouklia has a marina, Vouklia-Meni has a marina. All of those marinas are being redeveloped. Although in those areas you can't buy for 250 anymore. It's only the Piraeus port area where you can invest for 250. You're not getting a lot for 250, though. I've looked at a lot of the properties that we have available there now. You're not going to buy a 3-bedroom apartment with a beautiful terrace and a fantastic view for 250,000 euros. I think you're looking at a 1-bedroom, maybe a 2-bedroom, if you're lucky. So I think people have to just temper their expectations in the area. It's already seen significant price increases.
That's true. But again, you know, you're looking at an area that, you know, if you want to take advantage of your property, you'll end up, renting out your property. So 1-bedroom, 2-bedroom is a much better investment. if you look from it that way.
Yeah, no, sure. That's definitely basic investment. Investment 101. I think it's more if you're looking to live in it, that one starts looking at different criteria. Let's look a little bit at what's happening on Crete. Crete is the biggest island in Greece. It's got international airports, three airports, right? But one international airport and two local airports. Ferries that run continuously. I know you do a lot of work there. You've just returned from another day trip. Tell us a little bit more about the island. I know you're the local, you're the Athenian and our resident Greek. So I have to defer to your information on the island.
So well, you have me talking for one of my favorite places in Greece. Crete is very interesting. We get, again, you can find there new developments, really nice developments, different from what you find in Piraeus. Crete is very interesting because although it's an island, we are talking about a property that can be, leased out all year round. Crete is a very big island. It's accessible throughout the year, from all the big cities in Athens through airplane, and of course from abroad, because it has an international airport, as you mentioned. So I think it's really, a beautiful place, really nice properties that you can find there. And
I think the interesting thing is the fact that you have year round traffic, because large parts of the Greek islands, you don't have that continuous access through the year. Some of these smaller islands literally get mothballed in winter, and you just don't have a lot of activity. Whereas on Crete, there is always feet across the doors. So it's a busy island, but still beautiful. I think busy but beautiful enough that one can have a good experience if you wanted to just go on holiday.
Definitely, it's an amazing place to go to holiday. The water is—it's just amazing.
And it's a good investment. I think that's the attraction. There's just a few images of properties we have there. Let's have a look at Paros next. It's a little bit different from Crete. I know this is another one of your favorite islands. I didn't choose these specifically because they're your favorite places. So by the way, these are just islands where people love to go and people love to invest, and many people love to actually go and settle there. Tell us a little bit more just about your experience of Paros. Why would you invest in Paros?
Well, first of all, let me say that we get a lot of investors for both islands, Crete and Paros. And again, the reason is because these islands do have the ground for, brand new developments, nice properties that an investor would feel like it's worth it to go and invest there. So Paros, although we're talking about a very different type and scenery of an island, is again a quite big island. It's the third biggest, if I'm not mistaken, of the Cyclades islands. And again, it has an airport. You get year-round flights from Athens, Crete, Thessaloniki to Paros. And then seasonally, you get flights from, other countries going to Paros Airport, which I think it's very important because it makes it very easy to, travel to the island all year round. Other than that, it's where it is located is just in the middle, so it can be used as, traveling from Paros to other areas. So it's very
easy to explore the rest.
So it's very easy from there to travel elsewhere. And again, it's a very beautiful place, a very popular place. It's, a lot of tourists go there every year. So it's very interesting in that way. And it has a very long season. So imagine that the touristic season in Paros starts, around Easter, around April usually, and it ends in October.
Yeah, that is quite long because some of the islands are quite short. It's not really that sunny and hot absolutely everywhere. So it's good to know that the activity is there. And once again, a good investment if you can still find an investment at the 250 level, given the price increases and the volume of tourism and people that live there permanently, I think we'll see good capital growth on these.
And the popularity of the place, of course. I mean, yes. 250, it's a really good price for an island like Paros.
Yes. No, I agree with you there. Let's have a look at how the golden visa works. I think this is important for people to understand. So the first thing that you get after you successfully apply is that you have Schengen access. Now, for some that may or may not be interesting, but you have visa-free access to the rest of the Schengen. I think for me, what is critical and what's very interesting about the Greek Golden Visa program is that you don't actually have to reside or spend any time there in order to maintain the benefit. So you have to make one visit for your biometrics appointment, and then you don't have to spend any time there to maintain. But I think after somebody visits the first time, they probably would like to spend more time there rather than less. But the point is you have the right to stay there permanently, but not the obligation to spend any time. So that's a big plus. It's a good investment. We've spoken about that. And then just how the family works. So I know that you can include your parents, regardless of whether they're dependent on you or not, your in-laws as well, if you'd like to take them with. Then you can, not everybody wants to do that. So you have to tell them that they have the right to come along, and you can include your children up to the age of 21. In terms of them qualifying, they have to be students and they have to be dependent on you. And once they're older than 21, they can be included up to 24, correct? Provided that they are still full-time students and dependent on you.
And not married.
And not married. There we go. And single. Very important. And then probably the biggest plus is the fact that it's such a fast processing time. I live in Portugal, and I've over the years done hundreds of applications for people to Portugal. And it's a very long and a very time consuming process in Portugal because of the interest and the backlog. Have you seen an increase in processing time because of the renewed interest and the increase in applications? Because that's a big concern for people. You know, when the paperwork says 2 months, but the reality is 5 or 6 or 12 months. How has that been playing out?
That's actually a really good question. So last year, when we had the first increase, of course, as you imagine, there was again a lot of people that rushed to come and apply for the program. And we started then facing some delays. So what the authorities did is that they opened up more immigration offices. So we had a very small period of delays, but now everything is back to normal because we have more immigration offices available. So I would say okay. No, absolutely no delay. And I don't think, and given that in the past, the government saw the problem and it was, you know, acted really, really fast. I believe they will do the same if we start seeing that there are delays.
Do you think we could ask them to come and help us here in Portugal to solve the backlog problem? That's probably politically not a good suggestion to make. All right, let's have a look at just kind of the specific benefits one has of a Greek Golden Visa. Although are eligible to apply for citizenship after 7, I have never had any client learn fluent Greek and pass a citizenship test, and therefore nobody has ever applied for Greek citizenship. I don't know if you have had a different experience.
No, I will have to say that we had many confident clients that they thought they could learn Greek and eventually, you know, apply for citizenship, but no one ever did. So,
yeah. So I think the message here is that Greece is a great residency program, and that is why it is also promoted as such. And although there's a route to citizenship, it should never be seen as a way to obtain European citizenship. You have to be really dedicated to make that work. The other plus for me is the fact that the residence permit can so easily be renewed because you don't have to spend any time there, and there isn't a lot of paperwork and documentation required. You just renew your residency permit every 5 years. So it's quite a nice long period to have your benefit without having to visit. It's a very good non-dom tax regime. So we've seen many non-doms moving from the UK now to Greece. So very good from a tax point of view. It's a safe and secured second home, so it's a great place for people to retire or just use as their home base when they travel through the rest of Europe. There's no minimum income requirement. Now, this is important because some of the other European programs do require this. You have to actually prove your financial worth and your eligibility and your income level to qualify for some of the other programs. So that's a big plus for Greece. And then the bank account requirement, I think, is also good. Some people do actually want a bank account, but it's quite a torturous process to open a bank account in Greece. It can be done, and many people do. But once again, it's not required. So we don't have to have a bank account when we start a client's application process. So that also makes it a little bit faster in terms of process. Talk about how the actual process works. So at the moment, most people have time to travel, although summer is a nice time. Limited time we have. Remember, you have to pay your team before the end of August. So by the 30th of August, you have to have paid your deposit. So very few people actually have the ability now to travel on time. So you can manage this whole process remotely. If you do choose to go in person, you'd have to go and choose the property pretty quickly and then go back for your biometrics appointment as your second appointment. So how we manage this process from a Latitude point of view is we do the initial consultation with our clients. We show them a whole series of property. We discuss the requirements and we then do the initial clients and help them select a property. And thereafter, we engage local council to assist. So could you just talk us through what happens after we engage a local law firm for our clients? What happens next?
So once all of the other steps that you mentioned are concluded, we basically draft and sign a power of attorney. With this power of attorney, we can represent the clients and do the whole process for them. Obviously, we do a due diligence on the property of their interest to make sure that the property is free of any burdens, mortgages, and so on. And following that, and given that everything is in order, we then gather all the needed documents for the contract. We sign the final purchase contract, register the contract, and then prepare the file for the residence permit application. Mm-hmm. All these steps sound longer than in reality are, because in about a month, we conclude everything. So in about a month, given that we have received the documents that we ask from the applicants, we file the application for the residence permit. Following that, in about 2 to 3 weeks, we receive the white paper, which is the temporary residence. It's just the document that the applicants get, and they can travel to Greece to give biometrics. Once they give biometrics, it takes again 4 to 5 weeks, and then we have the residence permit.
Yeah, so it really is a fast process. So biometrics, I'm often asked, what does this mean? Give biometrics,
fingerprints.
You visit a government office, you get an electronic photograph taken, and you leave your fingerprints behind. So interesting, in South Africa, we still have a wet ink fingerprint process. So it's always lovely for South Africans to travel where there is electronic fingerprints. Right, and then you receive your PR card, which is valid for 5 years. And you only have to go back again in 5 years to have it renewed.
Yes, in 5 years' time, the only requirement is that the main applicant still owes the property. So we get the documents. We actually issue the documents from the tax authority showing that the main applicant still has the full ownership of the property. We do the process, and then the applicants just have to enter and give biometrics again. So
there we go. So one visit every 5 years is all that is required. Mm-hmm. Just in terms of the actual requirements, that's a plus for Greece, because it takes you involved in all the other programs. And in Greece, the two main things that you need is a birth certificate if you include income your spouse. And that is really the only documents that you have to bring from outside in order to apply.
I think Yeah, I think it doesn't get simpler than that, you know. Other, you know, you're aware that other programs ask for much more, like a criminal record or so on. This is what we ask for just to file the application.
Yeah. So the is who qualifies, holding the underlying property and being able to visit every 5 years for your biometrics, and then you'll have your access, your residency card issued.
Correct.
That is great, Nicole. Thanks. Thank you so much for that overview. At this point, if anybody has asked any questions, we'll Q&A section. We see any. We I see a question here about work. This is not a program that will allow you to work. So you do not get a work permit when you get residency in Greece. It's meant for people that are making an investment or potentially coming to retire there. Of course, you can run your business from there if you have a business, but you're not allowed to compete for a local job. So you're not employable in Greece. I see a citizenship question. We have answered the citizenship question. It is technically possible, but not something that you should kind of set your heart on of obtaining. There is Nicole, can you see any other questions there that we haven't covered? If anybody else wants to ask a question, please add so now. Otherwise, we will respond to anything afterwards. Do you have anything else you want to add, Nicole, just before we sign off?
Oh, I think we do have an answer if I think you mean if someone can start a business there. I'm not sure I understand. Can you rent the property or start a business? Okay. Yes, the property can be rented out long term. Short-term leases are not allowed, but you can long-term lease your property. And with this type of residence, you are allowed to set up a company, but you are not allowed to be an employee or actually run the company. So you can be the sole shareholder, but someone else has to represent and run the company, be the director, basically.
All right, I see a few more questions coming in now.
Oh, okay. If I may, I see another one on long-term leases. So, a
I see them
long-term.
popping. I see them popping up. You see them.
Sorry, I lost you there for a second. I'm sorry.
That's okay. It looks like your screen froze there for a second. I can answer that one. The law has recently changed. We're waiting for it to actually be published, but it's very unlikely that you will be able to use your property for short-term lettings and management. So you can't Airbnb your property the way it was possible in the past. There's still good long-term lettings contracts to be made, and many hospitality companies will rent your property from you for the long term, and they will run it as a hospitality business, but you won't be able to manage your property yourself as a short-term lettings business. All right, I think that's the main questions. If there's any other questions that come up, please do get in touch with the consultant that invited you. If not, just use the general email address and we can certainly get back to you and respond to you. But I think the main message is if you want to benefit from a 250,000 euro Greek golden visa, then the next couple of weeks is definitely the time to proceed. Otherwise, you will not be able to do this on time. Thank you very much. Thank you all for attending. Nicole, thank you very much for your time. I know the sun is still shining, but I hope you have a lovely evening. So thanks a lot for joining us today. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.